them today. The title is Cause Every Knee Will Bow. And unfortunately, that connotation right now is pretty negative about bowing, isn't it? Taking a knee. Everybody got that quick. But we're not going to talk about that. I'm not getting political, and we're not going to do anything about those, your opinions, one way or the other. But one day we will face that, and we will kneel. We will stand before him. And just like that song, I can only imagine, it says in there, you know, what will I do? Can I stand? Will I dance? Will I sing? Will I bow low to the ground? How will it feel? Since the times of kings and governments, bowing has been a sign of humility, a sign of respect, a sign of giving honor to somebody. It hasn't been a sign of protest. But that's, like I said, I can't do that. Okay. So as we kneel in prayer, and then, you know, a lot of us are taught to kneel in prayer. How many of you learned to pray besides your bed, kneeling as a child, and pray for people? Yep. And so that's, you know, a lot of times we think of praying as kneeling. As I listen to the song, I can only imagine, and I've watched the movie, I sense that awe, that desire to surrender, to bow in humility before my Savior. How will I feel or act, or what would I do when I stand before my Savior? The lyrics go, I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine when that day comes, when I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine when all I could do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Faith and surrender, putting our hand in Jesus' hand.
letting him have our next swearing in as well. It might be too simplistic maybe for us adults. We don't think of it that way, maybe because we feel and know how unworthy we really are when we see Jesus' face. That maybe that's why we feel all prostrate at his feet. Or we don't know how we'll be when we stand before Jesus at the end. Will we dance? Or will we be still? Will we kneel? Will we fall? Will we be silent? Or will we stand in awe? The scripture has a lot to say about facing Jesus one day. Philippians 2, 1-15, and it's on page 951 in your Pew Bibles if you want to follow along, or it'll be up on the screen. This is, therefore, if any have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but rather in humility value others above yourselves. Not looking to your own interest, but to your interest in others. Now we're going to stop and talk and we'll go back to it a little bit. I like this passage because it speaks about true humility and gives us an example of it. Jesus is our example. The early church took his example and they followed it. Ultimately, and unfortunately, most of us don't really understand true humility, true surrender, true sacrifice, as the early church did. When they accepted Christ, they knew they would probably die. They knew they would be persecuted. That early church knew what it would cost. Yet they still surrendered to Jesus. They still gave their lives to him. In the book, I started reading, actually, Diego sent it to me. And he and I are corresponding and reading this book together. And it's called The Way Back. And it is very provoking. It's making me think a lot. The author quotes Larry Osborne. He says, the New Testament church was birthed in a cultural and political cesspool. There were no family values. Sexual perversion was normative. Human life cheap. And justice non-existent for anyone except the rich and powerful. Yet none of the New Testament letters say anything about what we could call cultural warfare. And the passages that deal with spiritual warfare are always framed in the context of personal spirituality and righteousness. In the early church, when you became a Christian, you knew what would happen. You would probably be arrested. You would possibly be killed. That was the norm of the day. Roman Emperor Domitian, I'm not going to know that word, so I can take that class, murdered any Christian, even members of his own family, if they became Christians. Didn't care. He just got rid of them all. Many of the rest were made so that the Romans could have some fun going to the Colosseum. Anybody know what they did in the Colosseum with Christians? Fed them to the lions. Yep, they wanted to see what a Christian could do in front of a bunch of lions. I couldn't find pictures of that, which I guess is a lot. But, that was their sport. It was like taking your kid to the movies. It was like getting the birthday party together and everybody, let's go to the Colosseum and see who dies today. It was that kind of atmosphere, watching people die and be killed. So it isn't, we aren't there yet, says the culture, but that was pretty awful. It was a grisly thing. The Christians of the early church knew what would happen to them when they surrendered their lives to Christ. They knew that was a distinct possibility. No self-respecting Roman would ever die for their friends. They would be killed in an instant. But Christians, they stood firm. And Robbie Stark writes, he says, how could mere mortals remain defiant after being skinned and covered with salt? How could anyone keep the faith while being slowly roasted on a spit? Such performances seem virtually supernatural in and of themselves, and that was the effect they often had on their observers. When people watch these Christians refuse to turn away from Christ, it made them wonder what was going on. Jesus left behind a motley crew of people, a bunch of fishermen, a bunch of women, a bunch of other guys, nobody special, nobody that was a teacher. You were all special in God's eyes, but in the eyes of the culture and the people, they were just a motley crew of people. He left behind me so many. and says, when we have died to sin in ourselves, we are united with Christ. Through that union, we can be encouraged. We are Christ and we are filled with His Spirit. As we are united with Him, we have comfort from His love, sharing in His Spirit, tenderness and compassion. Paul is calling those that have been saved, those that have become followers of Christ, to be united to the Church of God. Not into denominations, though that might be a part of the whole, but Christians, people that live and breathe Jesus. Those that testify to faith in Christ are to do nothing out of selfish ambition, or so they can boast about it, but to put others ahead of themselves, not looking to their own interests, but to the interests of others. Not the interests of others first, not second. Not after we are caught up, and not after we have our house paid off, not after at the end of the day, but to look for opportunities first for others, to do to others first. The early church behaved so abnormally in the Roman culture that by their very lives being lived differently, many things began to change. Women's roles were elevated in the culture. Women were no longer looked on as possessions and material and property. They became women, and they became people in the eyes of the Roman culture. Christians refused to have abortions. Female children were as valued as male children, because guess who they aborted most of all, or got rid of later? Men began to care for their wives, take care of their families, and not have relationships outside of their marriages. They experienced joy despite persecution. They helped the poor and the needy, and they took care of widows and orphans. They pooled their resources together to help those families that took in the orphans and widows and unwanted children. Infanticide was dropped. Because in the Roman culture, if you didn't want your child, if you thought there was too many mouths to feed, or if you didn't want a girl, or if you didn't want a boy, whatever, they were leaving them outside on the step anywhere, on the corner, and let them die of exposure. They did it all the time. It was common practice to, if you decided you didn't want a child, I did. Can't imagine. But that's what the Christians, first, they outlawed it among themselves. They said, we aren't going to do that anymore. And this practice is stopping right here in their communities. And then they started picking up all these orphans. And they started raising them up. And then the church got together and pulled their resources together to take care of these unwanted children. And that started making a difference in Roman culture. They saw, you know, they didn't understand it. They didn't get it. Why would you do that? Why would you raise somebody else's child that they didn't want? But, so it was making a difference. And as Christians began to raise these abandoned children, the world looked on. Because of what these early Christians did, the Roman worldview began to change. Christians weren't judging them or condemning the people. They weren't telling them, you shouldn't do that. They weren't going over there and hollering at them and screaming at them or protesting. They were just being Jesus. They were picking up the children. They were taking care of things. They were showing their love through their own, that was their radical behavior. Was loving on those kids. Love under pressure made an impression that could not be ignored. Verses 5 to 8 read in Philippians 2, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. So we are to allow Jesus full reign in our lives. We need to let his thinking and his compassion for others and make it our own. We are to love like he loved. Jesus didn't lord his position over everybody. Jesus didn't say, I'm the Messiah, you better follow me. He loved everyone. He accepted him. He performed miracles not so that they would applaud him, but that they would glorify his heavenly Father. He did miracles because they benefited others. He did it out of genuine love and compassion for the people. He did it because it was the right thing to do. The early church changed Roman culture because they were totally sold out for Jesus Christ. They did what they did because they loved God and they loved others. And because they were so different there in their lives and their new beginnings, they began to change their culture because people would look on and try to understand where they were coming from. So let's make it personal. What could we do? What could South Troy Church Community do today that would so astonish non-believers that they would be forced to re-examine what we believe and why we believe it? What would grab the attention of a culture in a positive way that it would be talked about in homes and in the workplace and in the mainstream media? What could Christians do that non-believers would start talking about? Even though Jesus is God, he didn't tell everyone he was God, but he willingly took on human form and became like us. He made himself nothing. He was willing to be uncomfortable, unpopular, treated miserably. He allowed human beings to kill him on a cross. Jesus was totally surrendered to the will of the devil. Are we willing to be nothing, to be ignored, to be insulted, to be unpopular for doing the right thing? Early Christians weren't political. They had no voice in politics. They just were. From the movie, I Can Only Imagine, you get to meet Bart, the guy that wrote the song and sings the song, I Can Only Imagine. Bart's dad was an abusive alcoholic. And even though Bart became a Christian at camp when he was a kid, he lacked some maturity in his faith. I mean, all of us do, especially as we're getting started out. At 18, he got on his motorcycle and left home. And he wanted to find his fortune in music. That was Christian music. That was kind of nice. But he still, that was his attitude. There's where he went. And he finally had to deal. It came to the point where he had to finally deal with his relationship with his dad. It was still controlling him, basically. He was just not able to get a handle on it. So, you know, in the meantime, while he is out doing music and struggling with his own issues, his dad came to the end of himself, and he accepted Christ. And he started getting his act together. He fixed up the house. He quit drinking. He started to try to make a life in preparation for hopefully someday when Bart would come home. Because he kept writing Bart letters and Bart just threw them away. Bart hated his dad. He was angry. He was not willing to forgive his father. But through his music and through his producer, at least in the movie, I don't know, you know, some of it I'm sure it's Hollywood, but he was told to start to work on his relationship with his dad. You can't get anywhere the way you're feeling. And to write a song about it. And he wrote the song that we're talking about. But eventually, Bart comes home, and he discovers the man that God created his dad to be in the first place. And they build a new and wonderful relationship. The song, I Can Only Imagine, was a tribute to his dad.
Hold on. Lord, feel me. That can't be his real voice.
Is that me?
Yeah, I can do this. Hell, you can. And you're going to blink your eyes, and you're going to realize that life has got you nowhere because you chased some stupid dream.
I want you to know that I pray for you all the time. And I hope that you find whatever it is that you're looking for out there.
I'm sorry. What are you running from?
My dad.
Been right about it. Let that pain become your inspiration.
I have some stuff I need to sort out. And I deal with it the only way I know how. And that's to write a song.
What is this?
I want to make things right.
You and me.
My dad was a monster, and I saw God transform him.
You have a gift. You have a gift.
I didn't think that God could be that. And so I wrote this song for my dad.
Thank you.
saw his dad change. I like how it, he said in there, he goes, I didn't think God could do that. God can change anything. When you're sold out for Jesus Christ, he can change you. Jesus gave himself totally, and there was no holding back. The early church surrendered their lives to Christ, willing to lay them down for the sake of the gospel. They were willing to sacrifice their time, their careers, their possessions, their very lives to live out their faith. They knew, as they gave their all, that there was a greater reward in the future. Life forever with Jesus. The next few verses of the passage read, therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him, Jesus, the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven, and on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Because Jesus lived as he did, his Father, God, exalted him to the highest honor and gave him the name that is above every name. And as we come face to face with Jesus, we will know him, and we will honor him. Paul follows this passage with a therefore. And every time I read a therefore, I always wonder what it's there for. But it's because of Christ's example. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. Do everything without grumbling or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure children of God, without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky, as you hold firmly to the word of life. So Paul addresses the Philippian church. He says, as you have always obeyed, not only when I'm around, but even when I'm not there. Sounds like a quote from the basketball coach, John Wooden. The true test of a man's character is what he does when no one is watching. The Philippians not only lived like Christ while Paul was around, but he had heard that they were practicing what they professed. He heard that they were living out their faith. And he reminds them and us that it's God who works in us. It is God who gives us the strength that we need to live our life out as he's planned it for us. And as we live out our faith, surrender to Christ. We must do it without grumbling about it, without complaining. Sometimes as Christians look like sourpusses. We think, oh, we have to do so much and we're all so serious all the time. Well, that ain't the Christian life. I can just see Jesus laughing and sharing times with his friends. I don't think Jesus was a sourpuss and looked mad and hungry all the time. And we have to remember that. God wants us to enjoy the life. He wants us to live it out for him, completely surrendered. And that gives us a ton of freedom, because it gives us freedom from sin, it gives us freedom from guilt, it gives us freedom to live the life that God has called us to. God calls us to love him first, and then love people. When we live that way, people will see a difference. Paul says we will shine like stars in the sky. Well, we were in Alaska last week, we heard that the Aurora Borealis were going to be out. Now, while we were there, it was cloudy almost every day. But this day, when they were supposed to be out, it cleared up. So Mike set the alarm for 1:30 in the morning, and we thought we had found a place where you could see the sky. And so we all got up at 1:30, and we turned in the car and went out to the lake. And the sky was beautiful, and you could see the stars. Couldn't see the Aurora Borealis because in Alaska, there's a lot of trees. And they didn't get above the trees on the horizon. We weren't in a high enough spot to see them, but we did see a nice open sky. But you could see the stars, even though, yes, Peter.
Oh, we did see a moose.
We did see stars. But what, you know, amazed me too, I had to find the north, the Big Dipper, even a small light in a very dark place makes a big difference, doesn't it? Even those stars on that night provided a lot of light. Because we were pretty much away from, there wasn't any city lights where we were. But there was snow on the light in the sky. And it's fun to see, you know, imagine the difference in all of us were shining stars in our community. So shining for Jesus that we can make that much of a difference in our communities. That we can be that bright light that people see us and they see Christ in all that we say and all that we do. As Christians, we need to learn to affect our culture through love and the difference that God has made in our lives. We can be that light. In Micah 6:6-8, it says, what can we bring to the Lord? Should we bring the burnt offerings? Should we bow before God most high with offerings and calves? Should we offer the thousands of rams and 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Should we sacrifice our firstborn children to pay for our sins? No, O people. The Lord has told you what is good, and this is what he requires of you. To do what is right, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. What does God want from us? To do what is right, to love mercy, not just for ourselves, but to extend it to others, to walk humbly with our God, to be willing to have the same attitude as Jesus Christ. Irma Bombeck said, when I stand before God at the end of my life, I would hope that I would not have a single bit of talent left, and I could say, I used everything you gave me. Most of your credit to Paul wrote to young Timothy, he said, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, who correctly handles the word of truth. And later, Paul wrote about his own walk with God. He said, I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Paul knew what the future held. The future held way more than the past, because eternity is much longer than our little time spent here on earth. He knew that he would be seeing Jesus, that he had done what God called him to do. He had no regrets. He had surrendered his all. Are we willing to surrender our lives to Christ? That's where we begin. Our faith today might be just convenient. We might think we're better than the guy down the street. But are we where Jesus wants us to be? Are we willing to engage the culture and address the issues of our day with the truth of the gospel, the perspective of the gospel? What are some issues in our society, our culture, our local community, that if we address them fully from the gospel, people would be forced to rethink what they think about God? Well, these questions aren't made to make us think. I'm not trying to lay a big guilt trip on you or make you feel terrible. But I want you to think, how can we make a difference? What are the issues in our community that we can address with the gospel, not rumors, not anger, not protests, but the love of Jesus Christ? How can we, a small church, but those in the first church were probably less than 150 people that went out and they changed the world. The Roman culture changed and eventually became a Christian country just from that handful of people in the very beginning. We are passionate in a number of ways in South Park. We are doing a number of things. We are working at the Plainview Elgin Local Backpack. And that's coming up really soon to get it going again for the new school year. So how can you help with that? Well, you can volunteer to deliver and pick up backpacks, or pick up food and deliver it. You can help collect food. You can encourage participation. That's a big deal. We don't have as many families in that district that qualify for the program as could be on the program. So if you know families, I know we can't introducing maybe that all that kind of stuff, but if you know families, share with them that if they qualify for the federal lunch program, they qualify for this program. The food shelf is going to be beginning as the addition is completed, and we'll need volunteers to help with that and probably to help deliver food. We're meeting with a lot of the lawyer on the east side of Rochester. Put out by Fleet Farm practically. It's on 40th Street, South East. So it's a long ways for even people in town. And so in our community, we're the only one besides Elgin and Metropa where we get started. But we might have to have some people to help deliver some of the food to some of our people that don't have vehicles. There are people out here that don't have driver's licenses or cars, and they can't get to the food that they need. So that's one way you can help. The food shelf, so that's one, and we're obviously going to need money for the food and all that kind of stuff, and helping to put it on shelves. Shelves are, the Blue Valley Foundation gave us enough money for shelves and all that. We got that all taken care of, but we need to get it, you know, just people. We're passionate about children and helping children with families with children. Here again, we need volunteers. Since we're small, we can't hire a full-time children's pastor. But we can all pitch in and help. As we reach families, we'll see communities change as well. We can love on kids without a dad at home. We can love on single moms that need a break and some encouragement. We can help by using our gifts. We have one gentleman here in church that's helping people repair their vehicles for free. He said, if you know of anybody, let them know I'm willing to do that. And so we have somebody that's using his gift of mechanics to help people get their cars fixed. It's amazing. And people build shelves or buy groceries, give it right. There's so many ways that there's so many opportunities. We can be like that early church and affect change by being the church, by being united in our love for God and love for others. That takes humanity. It takes total surrender. So as you go about your week this week today, I challenge you to be a star shining. Find a way to engage our culture, to do the right thing no matter what the cost. On the back of our communication cards, there's always a spot on there, there's a blank space. I know it's a prayer request, but or it says comments as well. I mean, if there's something that you feel passionate about, or if you have some questions, or if you want to volunteer in any of these ways, put it on there, hand it to me, hand it to Gary, and you know, I'll call you or talk to you or email me or call me. But those would be ways, you know, to get some people signed up. One other way, foster care and adoption and crisis pregnancy centers all ways to help these abandoned children, the orphans of our culture. And New Life Family Services in Rochester, they're a great organization. They help with crisis pregnancies. Every once in a while, we've done a baby shower for them in the past. There's a number of ways we can help there. You can foster care, and Gary and I can tell you personally how to go about doing that. And adoption, you can also help. But, you know, those are a lot of ways that we can help. God might be touching your heart the way that you have never thought of before today. But feel open, be listening. Religion that God, our Father, accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. That's true religion. That's true following of Christ. That's true spirit. That's what it is. That's what it is. Dear Father, surrendering for most of us, that is the tough thing to think about. Saying, Lord, I'm yours. Do with me what you want. That's heavy stuff. And Father, I testify that's the best thing I've ever done with my life. And Lord, I am so thankful. And Lord, I just lift this up to you, and I just pray that you will touch hearts as you promised, and continue to encourage, continue to give us your strength and your grace as we follow and are obedient as a church and as individuals. May we seek to know what you have asked.